the end of the session. Thank you, President.
Questions. Question number one, Dr. The Honourable Priscilla LEUNG. President, the Director of the Hong Kong and Macau Affairs Office of the State Council indicated earlier his hope that by the time the country's second centennial goal was achieved, Hong Kong would have bid farewell to subdivided units or SDUs in caged homes. There are views that apart from endeavouring to increase the supply of subsidised housing, the government also needs to help households in inadequate housing such as caged homes, SDUs and cubicle apartments enhance their competitiveness so that they can seize the opportunities for upward mobility, thereby moving out of inadequate housing through their own effort. In this connection, would the government inform this council, one, of the respective numbers of households belonging to the following two categories currently living in inadequate housing? One, low-income households who are not living in public housing nor receiving CSSA and have received one-off living subsidy. And two, households who are not living in public housing or not receiving CSSA have waited for public housing for more than 3 years and are receiving the monthly cash allowance, not including non-elderly one-person public housing applicant. Two, whether it will, by drawing reference from the targeted poverty alleviation strategy adopted by the mainland authorities, help households in inadequate housing enhance their competitiveness through the provision of student learning support as well as services such as employment training and counselling so that they can seize the opportunities for upward mobility, thereby being able to afford housing with a better living environment. And three, whether the government will undertake that the development of transitional housing is only a temporary policy and that will not include that type of housing into the long-term housing strategy as part of the housing ladder. Secretary for Transport and Housing. Thank you, President. Having consulted relevant bureaus, my reply to the question raised by the Honourable Priscilla LEUNG is as follows. According to the information provided by the Home Affairs Bureau, to relieve the financial pressure of low-income households not living in public housing and not receiving CSSA, the Community Care Fund provided two rounds of one-off living subsidy to these households in 2020-21. As at end September 2021, around 115,000 households benefited under the first round of subsidy. It is expected that around 118,000 households would benefit under the second round. The government launched the three-year cash allowance trial scheme, or CATS, in late June this year to provide cash allowance to eligible public rental housing general applicant households, that is, applicant households with two or more persons and applicants under the single elderly priority scheme, which are not living in PRH, not receiving CSSA, and have waited for PRH for more than 3 years, but have not been offered the first PRH allocation with a view to relieving the pressure on livelihood of grassroots families who have waited for PRH allocation for a prolonged period of time. As at end September this year, the government has disbursed cash allowances to over 50,000 eligible general applicant households. In the two rounds of one-off living subsidy and the three-year CATS mentioned above, applicants are not required to declare if they reside in inadequate housing. As such, we do not have the relevant information. Poverty alleviation is one of the policy priorities of the Hong Kong SAR government. Bureaus and departments have been implementing appropriate support measures in accordance with their areas of responsibility. Bureaus or departments have devised relevant eligibility criteria and publicized these measures to enable the needy to come forward to apply. The government's poverty alleviation measures have effectively provided support to the targeted groups across the community. Applications are processed according to the application criteria, and such arrangements are open and transparent. As mentioned in the CE's policy address announced recently, the Hong Kong SAR government sets the official poverty line based on the concept and methodology of relative poverty, which only measures income without considering assets. The objective is to monitor the poverty situation and alleviate poverty with targeted efforts through regular data collection and analysis. According to statistics released at the end of last year, After taking into account all the cash and PRH benefits, the size of the poor population in 2019 decreased significantly from the pre-intervention of 1.49 million to 0.64 million. This shows the policies and measures can effectively achieve the function of income redistribution and lift grassroots out of poverty. Apart from the two measures for relieving difficulties faced by low-income families who are not living in public housing and not receiving CSS, as mentioned in the first part of the question, the Community Care Fund also implemented the assistance program to improve the living environment of low-income subdivided unit households to improve their living environment. The government has also introduced various support measures under different policy areas to cater for the needs of the underprivileged in various aspects. Please refer to the annex for these support measures. The government will continue to care for the needs of the underprivileged, including households in inadequate housing, and formulate appropriate policies to provide them with suitable support. Relevant bureaus and departments also endeavor to provide them with more information relevant to the support measures through suitable channels, organizations, and groups, and assist them to apply for these measures. Actively identifying land for housing construction is the fundamental solution to increasing public housing supply. The government has been adopting a multi-pronged approach to identify and form land, forging ahead to increase land supply in a sustained and all-embracing manner. After several years of efforts, the government has identified about 350 hectares of land, which can produce some 330,000 public housing units for the coming 10-year period. That can meet the estimated public housing demand of around 310,000 units in the same 10-year period. Public housing production in the 5-year tenure of the current term government is expected to reach 96,500 units, which is 30,000 units more than the previous 5-year period. To achieve the above 10-year public housing production, various government departments are striving to take forward relevant work and to improve coordination, with a view to completing the necessary land farming process and handing over the sites for development in time. We also endeavor to optimize the development potential of each and every public housing site and to expedite the development process. When the relevant housing supply is not yet available, the government has been actively taking forward the implementation of transitional housing through better use of short-term vacant land and buildings with a view to providing transitional housing to people with pressing housing needs. This will alleviate the hardship faced by families living in inadequate housing and have been waiting for PRH for a long time. As transitional housing is of short-term nature, the timing amount of its supply is not stable and will change at times. Therefore, it is not suitable to include transitional housing in the housing supply in the next 10 years, nor is it suitable to include transitional housing in the housing ladder. Thank you. Dr. Priscilla Leung. Thank you, President. On bidding farewell to SDUs is not just a question for THB. In fact, the CS4A should have come to address this question. My follow-up question is related to part two of the written reply. Saying goodbye to SDU needs both hard and soft policies. I hope THB, as the lead bureau to say goodbye to SDUs, should lead other bureaus and departments. So that instead of giving a person a man a fish, we should teach him how to fish. You should do some surveys. Many parents want you to help the children to have upward mobility, to give them tuition classes, and they can add value, and they can have tertiary education, and then they can say goodbye to SDUs. I think the vaccination program is a success by mobilizing the public sector. Now, THB will deal with the hard policy in increasing housing supply. Perhaps you should mobilize other bureaus and departments so that the business sector, the professional sector can help these 11,000 households. We can learn from the mainland. strategy of targeted poverty alleviation. Secretary, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Priscilla LEUNG, for your views. Indeed, helping households living in inadequate housing as well, frankly speaking, many of them are single-parent families, and they have a lot of aspirations for the next generation. They attach significance to education of their children so that there can be hope. In our annex, we have listed out various support measures for education. Our Undersecretary for Education can supplement. Now, in helping SDU households and those living in inadequate housing, as said by Dr. LEUNG, we need the commercial sector, developers, NGOs, and civic-minded persons to offer assistance in cash and in kind. And there are people who go out to provide assistance and advice and other supporting services. We'll continue to do this for SDUs and transitional housing households. Now, in SDU management, different bureaus and departments have been involved. For instance, in terms of environmental hygiene, we have legislation on public health. We've got the fire services ordinance by the FSD, and also with the buildings ordinance. And there is also an ordinance on buildings management. So we will follow up on all fronts. The Undersecretary for Education can supplement on what we're doing on the education front. Undersecretary for Education. This term of government attaches a lot of significance to education, as mentioned by Dr. LEUNG. In our education services panel, we have discussed a number of times all-rounded development of our students, whether in class or in extracurricular activities. We are helping personal growth of students in all-rounded development. We have a series of measures to help the underprivileged students to ensure that they will not be deprived of proper educational development as a result of a lack of means. Well, we have 12 years of free primary and secondary education and 3-year affordable KG education to ensure more opportunities for all-rounded development of students. There are learning experiences that need extra resources. We're providing different types of subsidies to schools. Some are calculated on a per capita basis and some on an event basis to support the underprivileged students so that at various stages, such subsidies can be used in a flexible manner, such as after-school learning subsidies. They are on two levels, one a school-based and second district-based, to help students. Schools can then, to meet their education needs, offer small group counseling and after-school support. And on a district basis, we mobilize NGOs to participate in providing assistance to students. We adopt a district-based approach because in addition to the support of families and schools, we want to enlist the help of NGOs to help the underprivileged students so that they can develop on various fronts. Which part of the question has not been answered? My direct question is, irrespective of the bureaus we're talking about, will we mobilize the efforts of the community, just like the vaccination program? When the commercial sector chipped in, there were a lot more resources. SCH, we have heard Dr. LEUNG's views. I will discuss with CS4A, and he will be invited to consider these comments. Mr. Abraham Sheikh, well, education is a cultural relationship issue. Mr. Sheikh, is your mobile phone on? No, there is nothing wrong with my mobile phone. It's not mine. Or perhaps there is some bugging going on. Housing is the outcome rather than the cause. The cause is poverty and also the wealth gap in society. Education is the solution to intergeneration poverty. The question was well answered, but that doesn't mean that you have done the policies right. You have not probed into the root causes. For instance, housing subsidy. Now, you talk about those on PRH, a waiting list for 5.8 years. What about those who have not even joined the waiting list? They're not receiving CSSA. How do you resolve their problems? Poor generation population has lowered from 1.49 million to 0.64 million, but you have taken into account people who are genuinely needy. Secretary, you are well-intentioned. I hope you can include these people so that those who are not on the PRH waiting list can live in a desirable environment. And you know, people are not yet on the PRH waiting list where the typical waiting time is 5.8 years. Secretary, for those living in inadequate housing, now for SDU households, according to our survey, there are about 35,000 households. Half of them are waiting for PRH and half of them are not for their own reasons. Now for poverty alleviation strategy, in a para 1.123 of disease policy address, now there are a few areas. First, we will continue to use CSSA OALA to assess needy elderly to be out of poverty. Secondly, we'll continue to develop the economy. We'll provide training and retraining to encourage employment, and we will use working family allowance to provide families with children in particular. And we will press ahead with a speedy construction of public housing because we need to provide affordable housing is an important factor in alleviation of poverty. So we will expedite the production of PRH. And for those who have been waiting for PRH for more than 3 years, they will have a cash subsidy. And under the principle of co-sharing, we enhance the retirement protection of MPF. Now for details, you can check the annex of my reply. If necessary, we can invite the relevant policy bureaus to provide extra information. Mr. Abraham Sheik, which part of your question been answered? Well, he talked about expediting the production of PRH, but yesterday we heard it would take 30 years before that 5.8 years could be shortened. That means that you're not expediting. Well, that's not your original question, Dr. Pierre Chen. Now, for SDUs, in addition to increasing supply, now there are landlords running SDUs and caged homes. They are really making millions of dollars per year, passive income. Now, in the government's legislation, there are ways to curb the rise of SDUs, but we haven't seen the government taking action. So you told us that you are trying very hard to increase land and supply. I think the question boils down to increase of supply from SU landlords and also the pressure on our grassroots. So how are you going to enforce your existing legislation so that we can be convinced that you're really trying to say goodbye to SDUs and the community? SCH. Now to address the question of inadequate housing in Hong Kong or SDUs, we have said on various occasions that the fundamental solution is to find land to build flats. We have got 350 hectares of land identified that can produce 330,000 PRH units. Under our 10-year housing supply scheme, we will be able to provide 301,000 units, enough to satisfy the demand for the coming 10-year period. In this year's policy address, the Northern Metropolis was proposed, and also a reclamation at Central Waters. Secretary for Development, Mr. Michael WONG, has made it very clear that when land is formed in these two projects, we will have enough land to provide 1 million units covering both public and private housing. Now, in the whole of Hong Kong, we have only 2.8 9 million flats in total. So an addition of 1 million flats will account for one-third of our existing stock. I believe that will give us enough land to build enough flats for everyone to be adequately housed. Dr. Chen asked whether we have any policy indicator to curb the growth of SDUs. I think we all understand that the appearance of SDU is not just about housing, but also the wealth gap. When grassroots families cannot afford decent housing with their own income, so they have no choice but to live in SDUs. Of course, this is undesirable and something we don't want to see. Given the tight supply of both public and private housing in Hong Kong, we can only expedite and enlarge the supply of PRH.
Question number two, Mr. WONG Kwok-kin. President, the National 14th Five-Year Plan puts forward supporting Hong Kong's development into an international innovation and technology hub or IT hub. In the policy address earlier this month, the chief executive proposes to develop a northern metropolis which includes a Sentin Technopro with an estimated capacity for 150,000 jobs in INT industries. Regarding the human resources planning, will the government inform this council, one, whether it has conducted surveys and studies on the demand and supply of INT manpower for the coming two decades so as to facilitate the formulation of human resources policies? If so, of the details, if not, whether it will expedite that, to whether it has formulated programs for nurturing local INT talents, if so, of the implementation timetables and other details, if not, whether it will expedite that, and three, whether it will assign the Human Resources Planning Commission led by the CS to coordinate the surveys and studies as well as the formulation of policies on INT human resources. If so, whether it will let the non-official members of the commission participate actively in policy formulation instead of only consulting them on policies put forward by the administration. Secretary for Innovation and Technology. President, the National 14th Five-Year Plan expresses clear support for Hong Kong's development into an international INT hub, which fully demonstrates the importance the central government attaches to Hong Kong's INT. Since the CE set forth the eight major areas for development INT, in the policy address, the current term, government has invested over $130 million and measures are gradually bearing fruit. In terms of talent, Hong Kong ranks second in terms of readiness in the World Talent Ranking 2020. The INT ecosystem in Hong Kong has also become increasingly vibrant. For example, the number of startups increased from 1,000 in 2014 to 3,800 in 2021, and that of employees rose from around 2,400 to 14,000 in the same period. There is satisfactory growth in the number of employees in the INT sector from 35,000 in 2014 to 45,000 in 2019. and R&D personnel from 29,000 to 36,000 in the same period. The categories of industries may be subject to change having regard to the times and technological development. The government agrees that the talent is an essential propeller for the development. Our consolidated reply in consultation with BDs is as follows. The report on manpower projection to 2027 released in 2019 has indicated Hong Kong has a keen demand for INT talent. That said, we are aware that relevant projections only assess general trends. More importantly, with rapid technological advancement, the projection of long-term INT manpower needs to be constantly updated in view of social, national and international development. Indeed, with the popularization of INT, various industries need to recruit a large number of INT talent. As set out in the policy address, INT land and infrastructure will be substantially expanded. We believe that the demand for INT manpower will increase further. The government has been adopting a multi-pronged approach in enlarging the local talent pool in order to nurture students' interest. The government is committed to promoting STEM education beyond the regular curriculum, the IT Innovation Lab in secondary school, and knowing more about IT programs subsidized secondary and primary schools, respectively, to organize extracurricular activities relating to IT. Universities will also incorporate technologies such as AI, blockchain in the curriculum. Over the past 5 years, around 9,800 students in STEM-related disciplines have graduated from the UGC-funded universities. Each year, some 1,700 are postgraduates. In order to attract university students to explore INT, STEM, the STEM internship scheme enables more university students in STEM disciplines to experience INT-related work. Over 4,100 students have benefited. The Hong Kong Science and Technology Park and Cyberport also provide internship and training opportunities. The Innovation and Technology Scholarship subsidizes university students to take part in overseas exchange, local scholar internship mentorship program. The government also launches schemes to assist youth in pursuing career in INT. The Research Talent Hub funds enterprises and research institutions to conduct R&D, having provided 5,400 research positions over the past 4 years. The Reindustrialization and Technology Training Program funds local enterprises on a matching basis. The VTC has also organized 260 STEM training programs involving some 7,700 participants. In close collaboration with the industry to incorporate workplace learning and assessment in its curricula, and in terms of pooling talent, opportunities for entrepreneurship and employment are the most effective means of attracting talent. With a view to facilitating talent admission, the Technology Talent Admission Scheme handles applicants or applications for admission of non-local talent to undertake R&D, covering 13 technology areas. The Global STEM Professorship Scheme supports universities in attracting INT scholars in teaching and research in Hong Kong. The government has also completed reviewing the talent list, setting out the scope of some professions to include experts of medical and healthcare sciences, microelectronics, integrated circuit design, and arts tech. The government will also double the annual quota of the Quality Migrant Admission Scheme to 4,000 to attract talent from all over the world to work in Hong Kong. And we explore the extension of immigration arrangement for non-local graduates to cover graduates of Hong Kong University's Greater Bay Area campuses. The Human Resources Planning Commission is a high-level policy consultation platform chaired by the CS to offer comments to the government on relevant policies and measures to develop Hong Kong into a high value-added and more diversified economy. The HRPC examined the major findings of the report on MP 2027 in May 2019 and offered comments on the directions to enhance the workforce in the future. In addition, the HRPC proactively offered comments on matters relating to the enhancement of the quality and increase in quantity of local INT talent at different meetings, including the various training and talent attraction measures introduced by the IT Bureau. To complement the active promotion of INT by the government, multiple BDs are involved in surveys and studies, as well as policy formulation. They will continue to review existing policies and measures, closely monitor the latest developments, as well as consult HRPC and stakeholders as appropriate. In conclusion, the government will work in partnership with different sectors to enhance the INT ecosystem and thereby leveraging our unique strengths and better integrating into the national development. Mr. WONG Kwok-kin, President, my question is very clear. I'm asking, in terms of the Northern Metropolis espoused in the policy address, what new thinking does the government have to nurture talent in Hong Kong? And what sort of planning does the government have going forward? In his reply, the secretary spent 8 minutes enumerating what has been done and what achievements have been made in the past. It stopped short of addressing specifically the questions that I raised. What we need to do is to understand how, in developing the Northern Metropolis and integrate Hong Kong into the GBA, and also to meet the needs under the 14th five-year plan, how we can nurture the right talent in terms of quality and quantity, and in terms of different areas, we should conduct an assessment. If the government hasn't done that, is it the right time for the government to conduct surveys and studies with a view to formulating a more specific and targeted plan? It's no good for you to enumerate all these past undertakings. This is not an answer to my question. Secretary, thanks very much for the reminder. In my principal reply, I have already mentioned that Hong Kong does have a manpower projection up to the year 2027. In the light of what Mr. WONG said in the policy address, and there is a clear plan for the development of INT, and it's going to be a dynamic and vibrant opportunity for the development in this area. In the process, we will look at the supply and demand of manpower in Hong Kong. As I said, there are 9,800 STEM-related students who graduate, and we are building up the talent pool. These elites, would they be joining the INT sector, or would they be suited to the market need? I think we have to move on with the times. So in my reply, I already said that we will resort to various means to make sure that the STEM graduates will join the INT sector. So we have the internship program, we have the research talent hub, and so on. And we will be collaborating with the universities to look at the 9,800 STEM students and see whether they are joining the INT field. Let me cite some examples. In various universities, they also have AI and blockchain, the cutting-edge technology training. I must emphasize, Mr. President, that we will not conduct a projection all of a sudden. The government has always had the manpower projection on an ongoing basis. And these manpower projections will have regard to the changing circumstances and update them accordingly. And we will also take into account members' views. The policy address has mapped out a very good blueprint for the INT development going forward. In our routine manpower projection exercise, all these will be taken into account in order to build up the talent pool. Mr. Jeffrey Lam, President, the whole world is competing for talent in the mainland of China and the neighboring regions. They are offering tax incentives to lure the INT talents, and they will be providing accommodation, put their kids in international schools and so on. But in Hong Kong, whenever we go past the talking stage, we merely paying lip service, and we're adopting this non-intervention policy. And we said that there should be some subsidies for people to identify opportunities. Now, my question for the administration is this. There will be tax incentives. Now, of course, you cannot tell us how much that would be, but will you be offering any tax incentives or any subsidies in terms of plans and accommodation and so on? I'm sure that that will lure a lot of talents to Hong Kong. Secretary, Mr. Lam said that we should entice INT talents to Hong Kong. Over the past couple of years, in fact, we have been doing a lot of that. You probably remember that we have implemented the STEM professorship scheme. We are supporting the universities to lure the STEM professors in Hong Kong, into Hong Kong for the first stage. 40 or so STEM professors have already come to Hong Kong in the first phase. At the enterprise level, we are resorting to various means to attract the talents. Like Mr. Lam said, tax incentive, we do have a super tax deduction scheme. If resources are devoted to R&D, there will be a 300% tax concession for the first $2 million in expenditure. Beyond that, and there will also be 200% tax deduction, and there is no limit to this. And this can be rolled over to the following year if the amount is not exhausted for a particular year. And this is going a long way to supporting the R&D development. In terms of resources and land, we have the reindustrialization support scheme, and $15 million is devoted on a 2-to-1 matching basis to support the reindustrialization. We also have the Advanced Manufacturing Center. We're building up the infrastructure in order to satisfy the demand in terms of land and in terms of equipment. All this will go on for the Advanced Manufacturing Center in mid-2020. The first one has already been up and running. And this is very popular, and we will be expanding this and create the second one there. Dr. N. Chiang, President, a young person told me once that in developing high-tech in Hong Kong, he doesn't pin very high upon that. When the Science Park was developed, he thought that there would be considerable resources to the development of high-end technology in Hong Kong. But having seen the Cyberport, having seen the Science and Technology Park, he feels that this is no more than a real estate project. The government is offering the land and build on the land and offer these for rent. Now we have the Hong Kong Shenzhen Innovation and Technology Park. We have the Technopole in Sentin. What kind of development is this in the future? What kind of investors will be lured into Hong Kong? And what area will these investors be investing in? Now, this young man is in the first year of university. He figures that by the time he finished postgraduate university education, he will be starting life in society. What sort of talent will be required? Should he do physics, biology, IT, biochemistry, or what? Can you offer any pointers to a young person like this? Secretary, thanks very much, Dr. Chiang. The government has been promoting INT, Science Park, and the cyber port have been developed to allow the entrepreneurs and young talents to flourish in these institutions. Our startups in Hong Kong have also increased in number by many, many fold. The number of people employed has increased from a mere 2,000 to more than 10,000. All this is attributed to the hard work and efforts on the part of all the stakeholders and the government. We will be sparing no effort in the days to come. So in the policy address, it is expressly stated that we will be supporting massively the INT development. Dr. Cheng has got a very good question. What area are we developing this Hong Kong into? In integrating Hong Kong into the national development, we have to understand what front-end technology is being developed in the mainland so that we can contribute to the development. Life science is an area that we can develop more of. But this is an area, this is all-encompassing. This covers the traditional medicine, chemistry, physics, big data, AI, and also robotics. And this may involve the development of micro robotics for medical surgical use. So for the young people, my word of advice is that they should take full advantage of this mega trend of INT development, and not just in Hong Kong, not just in the mainland, but also the world over. So I think we have to urge the young people to lay a good foundation. If they are engaging in STEM education, I'm sure that they will put the knowledge to good use and they will be able to unleash their potential. Dr. Cheng's question covers a very broad spectrum of area, but certainly STEM is the way to go. Mr. Leung Shi Cheng. Dr. Priscilla Leung. President, I'd like to ask the Secretary this. In the science faculties of universities, they fail to admit the right level of talents in Hong Kong. Now, this is mainly because at the secondary level, the students do not have as good a foundation as the students in the previous generations. They have to do physics. They used to have to do physics, chemistry, and biology, and now they have a choice of not doing all three. Many science professors asked me to put this question. And there is no liberal education, liberal studies. Now, how can we make sure that we can avoid a situation where the students are putting more emphasis on liberal subjects instead of science subjects? How are you going to rectify the imbalance at the secondary level? Secretary, we attach a lot of importance to primary and secondary schools, and so we do have a plan to review the curriculum. But the key thing is to attract the talents to study STEM education. I think we have to have a vibrant INT ecosystem. In the absence of any job opportunities, they can't be bothered doing these kind of subjects. So the key thing is to create a vibrant and dynamic INT ecosystem, and that would be of sufficient attraction. Dr. Leung, I'm asking about primary and secondary school when you were talking about university. And you might follow up on other occasions.
Question 3. Dr. Lo Wai-kwok. President, the State Council has given consent for Guangdong, Hong Kong, and Macau to host the 15th National Games in 2025. The Hong Kong government has indicated that the hosting of the National Games, which is a comprehensive sports event of the largest scale and the highest level in the country, jointly by the three places of Guangdong, Hong Kong, and Macau, carries a significant meaning, and the event will help promote sports development in Hong Kong. In this connection, would the government inform this council? 1. As it is expected that the Kai Tak Sports Park will not be completed until 2023, whether the government will expeditiously conduct a review on how the sports park could complement Hong Kong's efforts in hosting some of the competition events of the National Games, including whether the scale and mode of operation of the facility will be commensurate with those needed by the competition events which the government intends to bid for hosting in Hong Kong, if so, of the details and not the reasons for that. 2. Given that the government will allocate funding to the Hong Kong Sports Institute, HKSI, for the construction of a new facilities building to replace existing facilities on strength and conditioning, sports science and sports medicine in the HKSI sports complex, as well as renovation of the vacated parts of the sports complex, whether the government will expeditiously assess the impacts of the relevant works on athletes' training and preparation for the various competition events of the National Games and make corresponding arrangements to mitigate such impacts. If so, of the details, if not the reasons for that. And 3. Whether it has begun detailed discussions and coordination with the Guangdong and Macau authorities on issues relating to the National Games, including the roles of various parties and division of work among them. The estimated total expenditure and amounts of financial commitments to be made by various parties. If so, of the details, if not the reasons for that. Secretary for Home Affairs. President, the Hong Kong-China delegation performed brilliantly at the Tokyo Olympic Games, achieving the best results of 1 gold, 2 silver, and 3 bronze medals in Hong Kong's history. Attained remarkable and encouraging results of 2 silver and 3 bronze medals by giving its best at the Tokyo Paralympic Games, and at the 14th National Games, captured 2 gold and 5 bronze medals, making the entire community proud and lifted by its excellent performance. The success of Hong Kong athletes does not come about by chance. In addition to their own efforts and the support of different sectors, the government's policy directives and continuous allocation of resources are also indispensable. We have announced various measures conducive to the sustainable development of sports in Hong Kong, one of which is to expedite the construction of the new facilities building of the HKSI and strive for its completion by mid-2024. With a net operating floor area of about 8,935 square meters, the new facilities building will mainly provide 2 new training venues and expand the facilities on strength and conditioning, sports science, and sports medicine. The funding application of about $990 million for the main works was approved by the Finance Committee of the Legislative Council on October 8th this year. The National Games, held once every 4 years, is the nation's highest level and largest national multi-sports event. The Hong Kong SAR government is grateful for the trust and support of the central government in announcing on August 26 this year its agreement for Guangdong, Hong Kong, and Macau to host the 15th National Games in 2025. This is a significant move that will promote Hong Kong sports development following the distinguished achievements of the Hong Kong-China delegation at the Tokyo Olympic Games and Paralympic Games. We will spare no effort to work closely with the relevant ministries of the central government, the Guangdong province, and the Macau SAR government to carry out the preparatory work for the 15th National Games in 2025 according to the central authority's requirement of simple, safe, and wonderful in conducting the event. My reply to the 3 parts of the question is as follows. 1. The Kai Tak Sports Park will occupy 28 hectares of land. It will be the largest piece of sports infrastructure in Hong Kong, providing modern and multi-purpose facilities for sports and recreation with a view to enhancing the sports culture in Hong Kong. The main stadium of the sports park will adopt Pearl of the Orient as its facade design theme. It will provide 50,000 seats and features a retractable roof. This flexible design enables the organization of various sports events such as rugby and football events and a variety of entertainment and community events of different nature and scale. Furthermore, the indoor sports center of the sports park will comprise a main arena with 10,000 seats and an ancillary sports hall with a seating capacity of up to 500, making it a suitable venue for many indoor sports events such as table tennis, badminton, basketball, volleyball, handball, and fencing events. The 5,000-seat public sports ground of the sports park is also suitable for various sports such as athletics, rugby, and football. In short, upon completion, the sports park can be used for hosting various sports games and major events, including the different sports games in the 15th National Games. In addition, Hong Kong has other stadiums and grounds which are suitable for the organization of international or regional sports events. 2. The outstanding achievements of Hong Kong athletes are only made possible with the professional training and support services they receive. As more Hong Kong athletes have gained a place amongst the world's best, sports science and sports medicine support services become even more crucial, not only in enhancing the effectiveness of athletes' training, but also in avoiding injuries and facilitating a speedy recovery. We will expedite the construction of the new facilities building of the Hong Kong Sports Institute and strive for completion by mid-2024. As I said, with a net operating floor area of about 8,935 square meters, the new facilities building will mainly provide two new training venues and expand the facilities on strength and conditioning, sports science, and sports medicine. Its early commissioning will further enhance the support to athletes on sports science and sports medicine, which could increase athletes' chances of scaling new heights in high-level major games such as the Olympics, the Paralympics, the Asian Games, and the National Games. The Hong Kong SI will ensure that athletes' training in preparation for the National Games and various competitions will not be affected during the construction of the new facilities building. There is a certain distance between the construction site for the new facilities building and other buildings. The HKSI will adopt quieter construction techniques to minimize noises and environmental impacts. Upon the completion of the new building, the Sports Institute will relocate the existing facilities on strength and conditioning, sports science, and sports medicine to the new building before renovating the sports complex in order not to affect athletes' use of such facilities. During renovation, the Sports Institute will instruct the contractors to separate areas under renovation from areas for normal operation so that the surrounding environment will be protected and the training venues will not be affected. The Home Affairs Bureau maintains close contact with the Sports Bureau of the Guangdong Province and the Sports Bureau of the Macau SAR government on the preparatory work for the 15th National Games in 2025. The General Administration of Sport of China will later discuss with Guangdong, Hong Kong, and Macau the preparation of the 15th National Games, including the division of work and financial arrangements. Currently, I do not have any new updates, but I will come back to report to LetGo once we have any news. Thank you. Dr. Lo Wai-kwok. President, a secretary in answering question one, listed out the facilities in Kai Tak Sports Park. Well, it is certainly encouraging to see such high-level sports facilities, and with its completion in 2023, I'm sure it will be able to provide adequate facilities for the National Games. I hope Hong Kong will be able to organize more events during the National Games. However, for financial arrangements and expenditure, currently we do not have any details. I'm sure it will take much discussion before we know more about this. Kai Tak Sports Park, from design to construction, I'm sure you already have a budget and that we wouldn't incur any loss. Have you updated the assessment on the expenditure to ensure such a large facility will be sustainable in the future? Secretary.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Dr. Lo, for your question. I have visited the site at the Kai Tak Sports Park, and it is actually
very encouraging because in the planning, we see many open spaces and many of the arenas can be used for different purposes. Progress has been quite smooth. At the same time, we are exploring major events that can be brought to Hong Kong, to the sports park. The National Games actually come at a very appropriate time at the completion of our sports park. We have been working on this large infrastructure and we are not beginning right after completion. We are going to complete construction in 2023. There will still be a bit time for us to operate and to smooth things out for management of the facilities. And we hope there will also be bring other events into Hong Kong to ensure that when the National Games begin, everything will run smoothly. There are not many updates on the sports park right now because progress has been quite smooth. But we will come back to report to LegCo and to the public with new updates. And for sure, we will announce to the public if we're able to bring in major events to Hong Kong. Mr. Vincent Cheng. Thank you, President. Hong Kong athletes have achieved very good results in the Tokyo Olympics. And we are able to also to be very successful with 8 golds and also 5 bronzes in the games that are currently in progress. We are very happy to see the National Games coming into Hong Kong, and we hope that some of the more popular events could be held in Hong Kong. We also hope to be able to be part of the opening and closing ceremonies of the National Games, because if you're able to bring in elite athletes into Hong Kong, that will actually be very conducive to the sports development in Hong Kong. So I hope the Secretary will try your best to also to fight for having the opening and closing ceremonies to be held in Hong Kong. Thank you. Guangdong, Hong Kong, Macau will be co-hosting the National Games in 2025. The three sides will be working together to ensure that the National Games will be a huge success. Bringing in a popular sports events can really set the trend, and many people like to enjoy and appreciate sports events at a close distance. We hope to actually to have more elite athletes and then to make it more popular. We're also looking into industrializing this industry. With this new infrastructure coming into place, we hope that young people who are interested in sports will be able to choose this as their future career. We are working closely with Macau and Guangdong province to organize the games, and we certainly hope that we'll be able to bring this sports spirit into Hong Kong. I'm talking about the opening and closing ceremony. Can we also try to hold this in Hong Kong? Well, you have raised your question. Actually, we are going to try to make this National Games a huge success. However, for the details, we still need to discuss it with our counterparts, and once we have news, we'll sure we will announce it to the public. Mr. Jeffrey Lam. Well, it is a very good opportunity for us to showcase our unique features with such a major sporting event. We're not only strong in sports, we are also strong in arts and culture. The Hong Kong Palace Museum will be opening very soon. We're very happy to see this facility being ready. We also have good equestrian event grounds, and also for cycling events, we also have a world-class golf course in Hong Kong. Secretary, can you try to fight for more events to be held in Hong Kong for the National Games? I hope that the business sector will also work closely with you. All along, the business sector has hoped to increase or to introduce or attract more talents into Hong Kong. We hope that you will have a huge campaign on this major event. And of course, I also hope to see the opening ceremony of the National Games being held in Hong Kong. Thank you. Yes, so we're all very excited about the National Games being held in Hong Kong. We do have a huge competitive advantage with our new facilities. Other than the Kai Tak Sports Park, we also have other sports ground. And geographically speaking, we are also a very good place to hold water sports. And as a Mr. Lam said, we also have a world-class golf course. So this is an edge for us to hold major sports events. We will begin discussions with Guangdong Province and Macau and also the General Administration of Sport of China very soon. And for those events that we are confident about, and it for those that we do have the appropriate infrastructure, we will try our best to fight for these events to be held in Hong Kong. And in future, we can actually try to work on our planning for arts, culture, and sports to be combined together for a sustainable development, and I hope that we will all work together for a successful National Games in 2025. Mr. Ma Fong Kwok. President, the National Games is a very important sports event, and we're happy that Hong Kong can also be part of it. Have you assessed what kind of advantages we have and which events will be conducive to the overall sports development in Hong Kong? Mr. Vincent Cheng has already asked for the opening and closing to be held in Hong Kong. Are we just working passively to have all the events arranged for us? Can we also ask for certain events proactively? Thank you for your question. We are very happy that the central government has the confidence in allowing us, together with Macau and Guangdong, to hold the National Games. We have already thought about water sports, maybe even golf events, and fencing, table tennis, badminton, rugby. We are quite strong in these sports. And with this 50,000 seat main stadium in the sports park, it can certainly be attractive. This is actually a co-hosting of the National Games in the Greater Bay Area. We hope to send out the message that these three cities in the Greater Bay Area will be able to successfully organize a major sports event, because in future, with this experience, we'll be able to showcase our experience and success. Be rest assured, we're going to work with all parties to hold discussions as soon as possible and to arrange the national games to our best. Well, other than hardware, software will also have an advantage in the XRL and also with our the number of hotel rooms. We are going to work with all parties to discuss the future arrangements, including opening and closing ceremonies. Thank you. Mr. Lok Chong Hong. Thank you, President. Well, it is important to have the support of the business sector to promote sports development. The National Games will be important to the whole country, and it is also a very good opportunity for everyone to participate in sports. We have requested the government to invest more in sports and to encourage tax incentives for the business sector who promote sports. I think we should set out a pilot scheme during the National Games, because with the support of business sector, we can cut costs and also enhance a promotion. Can you also provide some incentives to the business sector? Secretary, we do see strong support from the business sector in the past. There has been huge investment in sports. The whole city has been very excited with major events such as the Olympics, and the government is also willing to invest in sports development, and it can also bring positive branding to some companies. We have already provided some tax incentives for the business sector. We are also going to work in also strengthening the support in the future.
Question 4, Mr. Vincent Cheng. Thank you, President. Hong Kong athletes achieved brilliant results in both in Tokyo Summer Olympic Games and the Paralympic Games, causing a sports fever among the people of Hong Kong. It is reported that some members of the sports community, academics, and members of this council have proposed that the government should sustain such fever and improve the sports facility and policies. In addition, the State Council has decided Guangdong, Hong Kong, Macau will host the 15th National Games in 2025 and required the governments of the three places to fully utilize the existing venues and facilities as well as contain the costs for hosting the competition events. In this connection with the government, informed this council, one, of the respective current shortfalls of venues for various sports across the territory as calculated on the basis of the reference standards stipulated in Hong Kong's planning standards and guidelines, the current number of those facilities that are below the reference international standards. Two, given that the five-year plan for sports and recreation facilities put forward in 2017 included conducting technical feasibility studies on 15 sports and recreation facility projects of the study outcome of the 11 sports facility projects among them, as well as the respective anticipated commencement and completion dates of the works concerned, whether it will consider rolling out a second five-year plan for sports and recreation facilities, if so, out of details. And three, of the National Games competition events that the government plans to strive for hosting, and whether it will strive for the opening ceremony or closing ceremony of the National Games to be held in Hong Kong, as well as the sports facilities that it intends to use. Secretary for Home Affairs. President, thank you. Thank you, Madam Deputy. Attaching great importance to sports development, the government of the Hong Kong Special Administrative Region, Hong Kong SAR, has been promoting sports development in Hong Kong through a three-pronged strategic approach, namely promoting sports in the community, supporting elite sports, and maintaining Hong Kong as a center for major international sport events. We will also increase and enhance sports and recreation facilities, as well as encourage collaboration among communities in fostering a strong sports culture in Hong Kong. In the policy address in January 2017, the government announced a five-year plan for sports and recreation facilities, the five-year plan, to launch 26 projects and conduct in technical feasibility studies for 15 sports and recreation facilities involving an amount of $20 billion. This is to develop new sports and recreation facilities and improve existing ones with a view to meeting the demand of the public and promoting greater sports participation in the community. While building new sports facilities, we also make good use of and upgrade existing facilities. Therefore, the government announced in the 2021-22 budget to earmark $318 million to implement a five-year plan for upgrading over 70 football pitches in order to provide more football pitches meeting the standards of the Fédération Internationale de Football de Association, thereby contributing to the development of football in Hong Kong. My reply to questions raised by Mr. Vincent Chang is as follows. Apart from the sports and recreation facilities provided by the Leisure and Cultural Services Department at CSE, other organizations including schools, private sports clubs, public housing estates, and private residential estates also provide different sports and recreation facilities. With regard to the major fee charging sports and recreation facilities provided by LCSE, there is a shortfall of 11.8 sports centers, a shortfall of 11 aside football pitches, a shortfall of 4.6 sports ground, and a surplus of 16.2 swimming pool complexes as compared to the provision recommended by the Hong Kong Planning Standards and Guidelines. LCSD does not keep record on the number of sports facilities not meeting international standards concerned. The Home Affairs Bureau, HAB, reported to the panel on Home Affairs of the Legislative Council, LegCo, on the 27th of September 2021 on the consultancy study on provision of sports facilities in Hong Kong conducted by the consultants. The consultants conducted a telephone survey to collect the latest population preferences for sports activities and provided recommendations on the planning of community sports facilities for the general public. Besides, the consultants made reference to other jurisdictions and surveyed the need of various stakeholders, such as the National Sports Associations, on the demand and usage of the current sports facilities, thereby worked out the number of additional territorial and regional sports facilities required in 5 and 10 years to cater for athletes' training and competition needs so identified. The consultants recommended formulating a facility hierarchy, devising new population-based provision standards for core sports facilities for community use, as well as introducing a new methodology to assess provision levels for sports facilities, etc. The consultants will engage various stakeholders on the study recommendations, taking into account their feedback, the methodology to assess the demand and supply of sports facilities, as well as the existing provision standard of sports facilities might need to be changed with a view to better addressing the evolving needs for sports facilities arising from an ever-changing sports behavior and pattern. 2. With regards to the five-year plan as mentioned above, among the 26 projects, 21 of them have obtained funding approval from LegCo, involving around $7.7 billion in total. Facilities in 7 of these approved projects have been opened or scheduled for opening this year for public use, while the pre-construction activities, construction works for another 9 projects have commenced. Construction design works for the remaining 5 projects will commence within this year. Projects with approved funding from the LegCo will provide 3 heated swimming pools and 15 open spaces, including 2 7 aside football pitches, 2 5 aside football pitches, 4 tennis courts, 8 basketball courts, 2 lawn bowling greens, and 2 cycling grounds for public use, as well as implement the pre-construction facility activities for the redevelopment of 1 sports ground and 1 amenity complex comprising sports center and swimming pool. Rest of the 15 projects for conducting technical feasibility studies, construction works for 1 project have commenced, and the studies for 4 projects have completed, with the remaining 10 ongoing. Subject to the technical feasibility being ascertained, HAB will apply for funding for these projects in due course. 3. The SAR government is grateful for the trust and support of the central government in announcing on the 26th of August this year its agreement for Guangdong, Hong Kong, Macau to host the 15th National Games in 2025. We will spare no effort to work closely with the relevant ministries of the central government, the Guangdong province, and the Macau SAR government to carry out the preparatory work for the Games in 2029, working to the central authorities' requirement of simple, safe, and wonderful in conducting the event. The Kai Tak Sports Park will be commissioned in 2023, together with the Hong Kong Velodrome, where many international competitions have been held, and other sports facilities. The foundation is in place for Hong Kong to take part in hosting the 15 Games. National Games. The General Administration of Sport of China will later convene a meeting with Guangdong, Hong Kong, and Macau over event preparation of the Games, including the division of work and financial arrangements. Thank you. Mr. Vincent Chang. Thank you, Madam Deputy. Well, there's always been voice in the community that we don't have sufficient sports facilities, we don't need experts to tell us. I wrote to the Home Affairs Bureau earlier how many venues we're short of. Now, we know that around the territory there is a shortfall of 148 sports venues. That's why there's a serious shortage, and so there's much touting for sports facilities. Yesterday, at around 9 a.m., I saw many people queuing up to book a sports venue. So every morning, there's a long queue. So really, you shouldn't do that. We just want to play football. Now, for the five-year plan, it's almost coming to an end. Are you going to start another five-year plan very soon? Would you consider that? And then in the older districts, there are some sports facilities that are really dilapidated. Would you give priority to upgrade them? Secretary, while I love sports too myself, like you, Mr. Cheng, so I fully appreciate that the public have to have a hard time finding sports venues. But of course, people are also smart, then they then turn to jogging and hiking. But still, we know there's a strong demand for sports facilities, and it's good for the health of the people of Hong Kong as a whole. So you don't need to be worried. If there are new plans for sports facilities and we want to speed up these facilities, or we want to add more facilities, definitely we will come to LegCo without any hesitation, and I'm sure members will support these projects, and so we could together promote the early completion of these hardwares. But of course you know, there are always emerging sports, so people's preferences for sports may change. For example, now young people and even adults like to do skateboarding. So how do we make plans for future sports facilities in accordance with the latest trend? We need to do more studies, because otherwise, if maybe we build certain facilities, it will be a waste. Although it's still good because we have more facilities to promote sport, but in any case, we want to follow closely the latest sports trend. Dr. Pia Chen, Melbourne Deputy, part one of the main reply. There's a shortfall of 12.911 aside football pitches. I don't know how, do you know how your colleagues came up with this calculation? Now, sometimes you go by the Hong Kong Planning Standards and Guidelines in your calculation. Sometimes you go by the standard designs of FIFA. But we don't know when you follow which set of standards. It's really up to you. So a shortfall of 12.911 aside football pitches. Can I share with you some of the figures I've got? I've been to different district councils. According to the Hong Kong Planning Standards and Guidelines, for there should be a football pitch for every 100,000 population. Now, some of the football pitches are not open to the public, so they are not counted towards the standard. That's what in the government document. For example, in Kwun Tong, there is a population of 500,000. There are just two football pitches, so there is a shortfall of four. Yuen Long, over 600,000 people, one 11-a-side football pitch, so there's a shortfall of five. Kwai Ting, 500,000 people, just one 11-a-side football pitch. I don't count the football pitches in playgrounds, because that's what the government said. So there's a shortfall of four in the Eastern District. Apart from the football pitch in the Siu Shai Wan Sports Ground, which, well, that, because there's inside Sports Ground, so it's not counted, so there's a shortfall of five. So already I've counted 18 in terms of shortfall. And then you, your shortfall is 12.9, probably you base it on the whole territory. Now, say if you put all 15 football pitches in Lantau tomorrow, then of course you have met the shortfall. Is that how you resolve the matter? Does it mean that people in future will have to travel from the Eastern District to Lantau to play football, and then they will all be happy? Is that how it should be counted? I think you should go by districts, right? So how do you actually look at the shortfall in various districts? Secretary, thank you for your concern, as you know. Well, I love to play football too, and you too, I know. For our future plans, we have to consider the demographic changes and demands. Now, for people who love football, of course, we would like to see more football pitches. But then in developed areas, it may not be easy to find land for that purpose. So it's all about land. And of course, then we consider other options. Maybe when we can't find enough people to play 11-a-side football games, then what are we promoting now? We're promoting 5-a-side or 7-a-side football games, because then we could provide these pitches and we could encourage young people to play football because more easily, because they are able to form teams more easily, and then they could also even participate in competitions. Now, where we could find land to build facilities, we will try to strive to do so. But then what is important is that we need to upgrade sports facilities as well. That's why in the 2020 to 21 budget, there's an announcement of setting aside of $318 million to implement a 5-year plan for upgrading football pitches. Now, because there's been a change in the planning for football pitches, so for old football pitches, they may not need the latest standards, so we need to upgrade them to meet international standards. And then also, where there's a shortfall in certain districts, we can't just put all football pitches in Lantau, for instance. We want people to enjoy sports facilities in their own district. So where there's a shortage of land, then we would like to, say, provide more 5-a-side or 7-a-side football pitches to meet the needs. So we'll continue to work very hard on providing venues. Hopefully we could offer more sports facilities for Hong Kong people who love to play sports. Mr. Horace Cheng, the Madam Deputy, the Secretary mentioned that the Hong Kong high-tech sports park will be completed in 2023. For commissioning. And you know, then there will be many major international events or mega events that will be hosted in the Kai Tak Sports Park. So what will happen to the Hong Kong Sports Stadium? What will be its positioning? I'm sure the government would agree that site should be turned into a community sports ground. So how do we do that? For example, you could build more tracks and add other sports facilities, so the public could really enjoy that venue. And this is what the public would like to see. So my question for the Secretary is this. I think there's a consensus already. This is the direction we want to move in, but I've heard the government is actually considering redeveloping the entire Hong Kong sports stadium. But then the sports sector thing is a waste of effort and money. So can you instead go for just a modification that saves time and money, and that's also in line with some environmental protection? So what is the fate of the Hong Kong sports ground? Can you tell us about that? And could you just modify the sports stadium so there will be community sports facilities very soon for the community? Secretary, well, yes, we do have certain plans for the Hong Kong sports stadium, but first of all, we have to complete the Hong Kai Tak Sports Park first. Because at the moment, the Hong Kong Sports Stadium is the largest stadium. If we do modification now, then we won't have a big enough stadium. But in any case, we hope to complete the Kai Tak Sports Park as soon as possible. And after it's commissioned, then we will move quickly to either upgrade or modify or convert the Hong Kong Sports Stadium. It won't be cost effective to redevelop the stadium altogether. Now, you know, probably know about the history of the Hong Kong Sports Stadium. In the past, there was a running track. So maybe in future, we'll consider whether to add to running tracks. So the public could enjoy this wonderful facility. And we don't need so many seats for mega events at the Hong Kong Sports Stadium. Well, that's something we'll consider in future conversion. And of course, sports house. The sports sector is very much concerned about the fate of sports house. Maybe in future, we could provide more space for national sports associations for their offices or whatever. This is something we will study, consider as well. And then we may also consider to keep certain seats, because there's a shortage of sports venues for schools to host their sports events. So this is again something we'll consider for the future development of the sports stadium. If we have any decision, we'll certainly report to the district council and this council. Mr. Horchung, which part of your question has been answered? Has not been answered. Now, I asked whether it will be conversion or redevelopment, that the secretary kept mentioning redevelopment. Is it actually redevelopment or conversion? No, sorry, perhaps I didn't make myself clear. We're not going to demolish and rebuild it, so it's actually conversion. Mr. Leung Chi Cheung, I was a member of the regional council. And so some sports facilities were planned for the new territories. But then after the regional council was disbanded, some of these sports facilities in the new territory did not go ahead. I remember there was a plan for a mini Hong Kong Coliseum in the new territories. For sports venues now, they are going in the direction of being small and scattered. So we're going to have the North Metropolis. So as the Secretary for Home Affairs, would you suggest to the government to build a relatively large-scale and diversified sports facilities in that district? Secretary, now I'm in charge of sports and I love sports. Of course, I would very much like to see more sports facilities being provided at the community level. Now, we're going to have the Northern Metropolis. This is a grand blueprint. Of course, in any district, it's important that we have enough support facilities, sports facilities, cultural facilities, and even, say, welfare facilities. These are all very important in the overall planning of a new district. So here we have this opportunity to study the long-term provision of sufficient support facilities in a new district. So when people live in that district, they will have this sense of happiness because they don't need to travel far to, say, take part in sports. So with the future planning of the district, I'm sure the Reference Bureau in charge of that will take bear this in mind. They will seize upon this opportunity to provide or upgrade the sports facilities in the metropolis. So I hope soon we will be enhancing communication with stakeholders in this council and to hear your views on these various plans. Mr. Michael Look. Now, sports facilities, are those managed by the government or in private sports clubs? But apart from that, we have to consider how there could be a sense of belonging among the local district for these sports facilities. There's a good way to do that. Say, it could help sports clubs to identify suitable venues and even subsidize them in building their facilities. Yunlong is a good example. Now, Yunlong, we have community hall with many training facilities. Now, apart from the first Hong Kong Games, in six games, Yunlong came first as the overall champion. So that's why it's because Yunlong has been active in promoting community sports. They've also trained many elite athletes, actually. So for any, say, new major sports facilities, could you set aside some space for district sports associations so they could, flourish? Secretary, yes, you're right. Yunlong was won more medals than others in many of the Hong Kong Games, and you mentioned the Yunlong Community Hall. Yes, there was upgrading works in the past to make it nicer, and so for major facilities to be planned for in the future. We'll see how we could work more closely with district councils. We're doing that actually already, say for schools or sports clubs. We ask them to open up their facilities to local organizations during non-peak hours. That is to make the use best use of sports venues. So we'll see how we could provide more sports facilities and promote more cooperation with NSA. Thank you.
Question 5. Mr. Michael Tien. Thank you, Madam Deputy. It was reported that in August this year, a major fire broke out at Siu Lam Flea Market in Tuen Mun, resulting in more than 100 stalls being burned down. Regarding the operations of the flea market, will the government inform this council, one, of the licenses and permits that the operators of such type of markets are required to obtain, the legal liabilities in respect of land use, fire safety, insurance, etc., to be fulfilled by operators, two, of the measures in place to ensure that the operators will fulfill the aforesaid liabilities, and whether it regularly conducts inspections and requires operators to regularly submit sub-reports in this regard. And three, of the current number of markets of the same type in Hong Kong, whether the government will comprehensively review the regulatory policies on such markets, including the requirement that operators should obtain licenses and permits, and the measures to monitor operators' fulfillment of the relevant terms and conditions, if so, of the details, if not the reasons for that. Secretary for Development. President, there is no universal definition of flea market. A general understanding is that the term broadly refers to a simple retail place where stalls gather together to operate. Nowadays, flea markets in community differ in nature and mode of operations. Some are initiated by civic organizations and operate with a specific community theme, while others are purely market-led commercial operations. From the perspective of land administration, land which can be used for flea markets use mainly includes the following three categories: private land or premises, which in accordance with the relevant lease conditions or with a waiver granted by the Lands Department, Lands D, can be used as a flea market or similar purposes. Two, short-term tenancy sites granted by direct grant by the Lands D on application by non-government organizations with support from the relevant policy bureau. And three, STT sites granted through open tender by the Lands D where composite uses including retail or marketplaces purposes are permitted. After consulting the Food and Health Bureau and the Security Bureau, my reply to three-part questions of Mr. Tien is as follows. One, depending on the operation details and scope of the activities, it may be necessary for a flea market to obtain relevant permits or licenses. As far as land use is concerned, the operations of a flea market must comply with the terms of the relevant land instrument, such as leases, waivers, or STTs, including the term on uses, subletting restrictions, etc. Otherwise, prior application must be made to the Lands D for many items of the relevant land instrument. If approved, the applicant will generally have to pay additional rent, premium, or waiver fee to reflect the increased value of the land and buildings. And appropriate terms will be imposed according to the advice of the relevant government departments. Regarding buildings and fire safety, the buildings ordinance stipulates that the building works on land under STT or private land can only commence upon obtaining approval of plans and consent to commencement of building works from the buildings department, unless they meet the requirements of the exempted works or belong to specified mining works under the mining works control system. The building works must also meet the design and construction standards on fire and structural safety under the building ordinance and its relevant subsidiary legislations. Moreover, if the relevant operations require applications for lands instruments, including the instrument for use as a flea market and or various types of licenses, the Fire Services Department will also impose in the land instruments or license requirements to provide fire services installation and equipment, ensure all means of escape from the venue are kept free from obstruction, etc. In addition, if the sale of cooked food or specified food products, for example, fresh or frozen meat, is involved in the market, relevant food licenses have to be obtained in accordance with the food business regulations. If the sale of liquor is involved, A liquor license has to be obtained in accordance with the dutiable commodities liquor regulations. If entertainment, e.g. stage performance, exhibition, etc., as defined as places of public entertainment ordinance is involved, a place of public entertainment license or temporary places of public entertainment license has to be obtained. As with other business activities in general, at present government departments have no particular requirements. Such flea markets should take out an insurance policy on their business operations. Operators can decide on their own, having regard to their business nature, risk and risk assessment, whether to procure an insurance policy for protecting themselves as well as ensuring they are able to fulfill any relevant legal responsibilities. 2. All relevant government departments enforce the requirements and conditions of the permits and licenses under their purview according to their established mechanisms, including regular inspections and follow-up investigations in response to complaints or reports. Where any irregularity is substantiated, enforcement actions will be taken, including the issuance of warnings and relevant instructions for rectification. In case of failure to rectify despite repeated prompting, actions to cancel the permit or license issued and criminal prosecution if contravention is involved will be considered. 3. The government does not have comprehensive statistics on flea markets and similar marketplaces. Since permission from the landlord is not required for individual markets operating in private premises where such uses are not in breach of the original land instrument, for example, those operating in a shopping center under a commercial lease. As far as those land instruments specifically permitting the use of flea markets or similar marketplaces are concerned, there are at present 3 flea markets or similar marketplaces operating under such instruments, not including the Siu Lang flea market in Chiman mentioned in the question, which is now closed, according to Lansdy information. With regard to regulation, the government currently has no intention to establish new licensing or regulatory systems for these markets. In fact, if business operators of such temporary nature have to go through elaborate and time-consuming approval processes, it will be difficult for such businesses to start operating. When considering the matter, the government has to take into account that the regulatory control should not unduly hinder the development of these small-sized business operations. Balancing relevant considerations, we are of the view that it's appropriate for government bureau and departments to maintain the existing practice of handling applications, monitoring compliance, and enforcing the requirements for these markets under their respective purview. Thank you. Mr. Michael Chen. Secretary, well, I'd like to talk about the open tender by Lands Department. You mentioned that you have no intention to establish new system, and yet you cite that they are temporary nature. Well, for the flea market question, altogether, have their leases extended to a total of 20 years? Well, for all the different departments providing different instrument at the first contract signing, the renewal more or less given a free pass for all the departments. This fire lasted for 5 hours. The fire service department sent 3 fire engines and 6 hoses. Altogether 38 fire engines and ambulances, and the whole flea market was burnt to the ground. Well, the silver lining was that there were no casualties. Therefore, it did not attract much public attention. Today, I'm representing the stall owners of the flea market, and I hope the government can continue to extend the lease to the food operating the flea market, and hope that you can heed my suggestion that you can perform all the supervision and inspection just like when the lease was first signed. We are now looking for and expect a positive reply from the secretary. Secretary, thank you, Mr. Chen's question. Well, my answer are positive to both questions. Well, the lease will run out on November, and the Lands Department will start a new tender exercise. For the site in question, we hope that it can stay as a flea market. It all depends whether we receive any bids. Second, since 2011, well, which was 11 years ago, as Michael Tien is concerned about fire safety, and there are now new requirements that the new lessor that they must upgrade the fire relief installation and allow inspections. If they do not complete the relevant procedure, we will terminate the lease. Well, Ms. Chen, so the answers are in the positive. Mr. Martin Liu. All around the world, the world famous flea markets are tourist magnets. Even though that there's not much tourists due to the COVID pandemic, however, they are still popular with local. But lacking the administration support, they cannot blossom. For example, the Siloam flea market, though it enjoyed the view of the Tsing Ma Bridge, well, due to the shrinking size and lack of a barbecue site, it was not as prosperous as it once were. Well, the government devised a policy to help to enhance the appeal of the flea markets in order to build a leisure-based Bay Area. Even without a travel bureau, at least can support the store owners to improve the environmental hygiene and safety, and provide festive decorations to attract local consumers and stimulate consumption, and should also consider comprehensive support policy. Will the government or administration consider so? Thank you, Mr. Liu's question. For the flea markets, I'll speak briefly, while I defer to the Undersecretary to speak about policy on bazaars. While we are providing the site for a flea market, well, let me cite some examples. In Meifu, there is a farmer's bazaar, and there's also the Qin Shi Wai bazaar at Qin Shi Wai. Well, the administration see there's a need after consulting the departments, and we managed to identify a suitable site. There, while the flea markets should be very accessible, and they also should be accessible by cars. Take Tin Sao Hui, for example. The Home Affairs Department and the Food and Health Bureau engaged NGOs to improve the operations of the flea markets. When the policy bureau or the local district office noticed such a need, and we will try to cooperate by providing a site. I'll let the Undersecretary to talk about the policies on bazaars. And thank you, Deputy. For the policies on bazaars, the government's position is that it will take a bottoms-up approach by initiation by residents or different civic organizations to propose their bazaar proposals. If the proponents can identify suitable locations, and while the owner hold no objections to the format and the operating hours, and such proposals win the support of the subcommittees under district councils, so long as not affect public order and food safety and environmental hygiene, and do not obstruct public passageway, so the government will liaise with different departments. While the successful bazaars were infused with different elements, for example, based on the district sentiments and development and culture elements to position themselves. For example, festive celebrations or culture or creativity or to promote tourism and allow the grassroots to set up their own business or even to alleviate poverty. Therefore, we respect the proposals made by civic organizations. I emphasize that the operations of the bazaar tend to be a short-term nature, and the venues are also non-permanent. Mr. Leung Chi-Chang, which part of the question not answered? My question is about whether any policy in place And he replied that what are the conditions to set up a bazaar. I'm asking for existing bazaars whether there will be any policy support. Any secretary can offer a direct response. And Madame Deputy, well, it really depends on the individual markets. Take Tinselhui, for example. We enlisted Tonghua Group of Hospitals. As I know that the Tonghua Group of Hospitals not only provide the venue for the stall owners, they also provide training for the stall operators to be commercially viable. Well, they involve different considerations. For the Siu Lam's case, it's a purely commercial operation, therefore there's less government intervention. Mr. Leung, thank you, Deputy. The Siu Lam flea market is a rather successful one in Hong Kong. Unfortunately, it was burnt down in a blaze, and the government will once again release the site for tender. That's one way to enhance a vibrant district economy. Most people hope that more support can be given to these flea markets so that they can help the local residents economically. That was the direction we envisioned. If there's too much red tape, that really may hinder their development. So, Secretary, besides the land use regulations, well, are there any fire safety regulations and other kind of regulations as cited by Mr. Chen? Not only you are streamlining the process, but not to the point, or also help to protect public safety. I wonder if you can come up with a balanced policy on that. Thank you, Mr. Leung's question. First, I would like to thank Mr. Leung for agreeing with the direction so that so we allow the flea market to continue under a new lease. As cited in the third part of my main reply, we agree that there will be less intervention as much as possible. There's too much regulation may scuffle that development. As for Mr. Leung's question, there are now new fire safety requirements and also on building and structure safety. If it's not accepted minor works, they will need to file in your building plans. For the cooked stalls, you ought to need to obtain the relevant food licenses. Well, these really are the ones that you need to be mindful of. There aren't any extra requirements. Mr. Wozenor. Thank you, Madam Deputy. In Secretary's main reply, I understand the government hope to stimulate community consumption. The reality, though, we've been asked by many stakeholders that the procedures are cumbersome and long processing time and lack department support. Well, you actually need departments to act as the main proponents. In terms of policy arrangements, how do we move with the times? So, Undersecretary for Food and Health, Dr. Choi, at the local level, whether for the wet markets or the bazaars, well, to organize a short-term group buys, there are a lot of obstacles to overcome. The frontline department told me that you need policy support for even for affordable goods, you need policy support. May I ask the food and health bureau, is there any way to examine the current framework? Besides reviewing that, we can able to remove the red tape so that you can let the grassroots to buy more affordable goods. Secretary, Undersecretary. Thank you, Deputy. In response to Mr. Orr's question, Well, for the bazaar or wet market facilities, for bazaars, there are non-permanent and short duration and non-permanent markets and initiated by civic organizations, and they're also required to apply. Since it's initiated by the public and a district-based matter and subject to the district culture or the different thematics orientation, since it's community-based, community consultation is important. There were examples at the local level after discussion at the local district level, which deemed it as viable before launch. When the venue operators also see it as viable, the departments will assist in the streamlining of the application procedures. Mr. Oi, which part of your question not answered? Well, he didn't say that whether they were streamlining the procedures to stimulate the local economy. Secretary, will you? Yes, we'll consider. Mr. Holden Chow. Madam Deputy, the Siloam flea market was burned down by a place. Well, I agree that we must keep the market. On the third part of your reply, the administration claims they do not have comprehensive statistics on flea markets. Well, the administration consider collecting statistics. A lot of colleagues mentioned that at least should offer policy support to bazaars and flea markets. That before providing policy support, you have to get hold of some data. And now that we don't even have such statistics, that made it very difficult to take forward policy support. Well, we need the numbers and the statistics before the policy support. Can the Bureau promise to perform the statistic collection on this? Secretary, Mr. Michael Wong. Well, that may be quite difficult. Well, in a main reply, the Lands Department issued various lands instruments. For private sites, they also call themselves a flea markets. Well, for example, the revitalized industry buildings also organize a flea markets. We are legitimate. Well, I need to talk about the Bureau in charge of retail policy. However, there's no data at this point.
Last question, seeking our reply, Mr. Jimmy NG. MWT. At present, an employer may use the accrued benefits of the contributions he made for an employee to a mandatory provident fund or MPF scheme to offset the statutory severance payment or long service payment payable by him to that employee. This is the so-called offsetting arrangement. The chief executive has stated in her policy address just delivered that legislation will be enacted in the next legislative session to abolish such arrangement. The government will also explore ways to encourage members of the public to convert, after retirement, their one-off MPF assets into annuities to be received regularly. Regarding the retirement protection system, will the government inform this council? One, as the business sector has all along been concerned about the rise in operating costs after the abolition of the offsetting arrangement of the measures put in place by the government to allay its concern. Two, whether it will step up publicity work on annuities to enhance public understanding on the design and merits on annuities to make good preparation for the implementation for conversion of MPF assets into annuities. And three, as a study report pointed out that it takes 40 years for a retirement protection system to become mature and the MPF system has been implemented for only 20 years, whether the government has any new directions in reforming the retirement protection system into one which provides comprehensive and timely retirement protection for the population of Hong Kong, if so, of the details, if not the reasons for that. Secretary for Labour and Welfare. Having consulted the Financial Services and the Treasury Bureau, my consolidated response to the member's question is set out below, Madam Deputy. One, the government will introduce the bills into the Legislative Council in the next legislative session with a view to abolishing the use of the accrued benefits of employers' mandatory contributions under the MPF system to offset severance payment and long service payment, and will implement the abolition of the offsetting arrangement upon full implementation of the EMPF platform of the Mandatory Provident Fund Schemes Authority in 2025. To help employers adapt to the policy change, the government will mandate employers to set up designated savings accounts or DSAs under their own name to save up for meeting their potential SP and LSP liabilities after the abolition. At the same time, the government will provide a 25-year subsidy to share out employers' expenses on SP and LSP after the abolition. As announced in the Chief Executive's 2021 Policy Address Supplement, having considered the business sector's views and concerns, we propose to refine the government subsidy scheme while maintaining roughly the same amount of the government's financial commitment and the same subsidy period to focus more on supporting micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises and provide more targeted assistance to employers to adapt to the policy change. Under the refined subsidy scheme, the calculation of subsidy will be simpler and easier to understand. As the calculation will be delinked from the balance of the employer's DSAs, employers can ascertain in advance the amount of subsidy to be received. During the initial years after the abolition, we will set a low capped amount so that employers will receive greater support and have more time in saving up their DSAs for getting prepared to shoulder their SP/LSC liabilities in the long run. 2. With a view to raising public awareness of annuity products, the HKMC Annuity Limited has been actively stepping up its education and publicity efforts in relation to life annuity, such as promoting the concept of life annuity and longevity risk management to target segments through different channels, including promotional videos, roving exhibitions, and public seminars. Moreover, to encourage MPF scheme members to convert their accumulated wealth into a lifelong, guaranteed, and steady retirement income, the HKMCA launched a premium discount campaign in July for MPF scheme members, further encouraging the public to convert their assets under the MPF into an annuity to provide a steady income for the elderly. 3. The MPF system, as one of the pillars of the multi-pronged retirement protection framework of Hong Kong, complements other pillars. The total MPF assets have been accumulated to over $1.2 trillion. The government and the MPFA have implemented multiple initiatives to enhance the MPF system, with the most important initiative being the MPF platform project. The platform will enhance the operational efficiency and reduce admin costs of the MPF system, and will also provide support and create favorable conditions for the implementation of full portability and other new initiatives and functions. As the platform becomes fully functional in 2025, the measure of the government paying 5% MPF contributions for persons whose income is below the MPF minimum relevant income level will be implemented. The government and the MPFA will continue to explore feasible measures to increase the choices and investment return of MPF funds to strengthen the function of MPF in generating greater value to scheme members. As more and more scheme members have reached the retirement age, the MPFA has put in place an arrangement called Investment Solutions Lab to enable the MPF industry to develop new retirement solutions and products that would cater for the investment needs of scheme members in the withdrawal phase to step up support for scheme members entering retirement age. In her policy address 2021, the chief executive pointed out that the government's poverty alleviation strategies will focus on four areas in the future. Among others, under the principle of shared responsibility, the government will strengthen the MPF retirement protection. The priority is to take forward the abolition of the offsetting arrangement by introducing legislative amendments in the next session. Moreover, the government will further explore ways to better encourage the public to convert their one-off assets under the MPF into an annuity, which they can receive on a regular basis after retirement to provide a steady income for the elderly. The public annuity program has been in operation for 3 years. It's now an opportune time to launch the above said study. I will lead a dedicated working group to conduct research over the subject of better encouraging the public to convert their assets under MPF into an annuity with the joint participation of the Labour and Welfare Bureau, Financial Services and the Treasury Bureau, Hong Kong Monetary Authority, MPFA, and Hong Kong Mortgage Corporation, etc. The working group will gather and analyze data available and study similar experience in other economies. The working group aims to submit a report which will propose various feasible directions applicable to the situation for Hong Kong as the foundation of more in-depth discussion by stakeholders from all sectors to the chief executive within the current term of the government. Mr. Jimmy NG, Madam Deputy, all along, in principle, the business sector is against the abolition of the MPF offsetting arrangement, and we have been fighting for an enhanced proposal. I'm happy that the government has agreed to make the amendments to the proposal, and the question now is what would happen going forward. And under the macro policy of integration into the Greater Bay Area, the portability of benefits across the boundary is very important. In terms of Hong Kong residents living on the mainland and the cross-boundary transfer of payments or subsidies, would the government look to expand the scope of the Guangdong scheme and other subsidy schemes to other provinces? And can the scope of the healthcare vouchers be expanded to cover the mainland? This would benefit the elderly people living on the mainland. Thank you very much for the questions, and I would offer a brief response. In terms of the future developments of the GBA, and in the context of the one-hour living circle, such livelihood measures are very important. In terms of welfare, there would be enhancements to the Guangdong and Fujian schemes. As for promotion to provinces outside of the GBA and Guangdong and Fujian provinces, we have no plans at the moment. Mr. Wong Kwok-kin, if you ask employees in Hong Kong whether they enjoy any retirement protection, the answer might be yes. But if you ask whether it is sufficient, I think the answer is also very clear. It's a no. MPF is part of the retirement protection system, and there are a lot of shortcomings as we have observed down the years. The government has agreed to abolish the offsetting arrangement, which was a partial response to the community. However, the time frame is way too long. We have to wait till 2025. Of course, the Secretary would say better late than never, but we hope that the government can expedite the work. As for the conversion of MPF benefits into annuities as an option, it can provide steady income for employees. It is a positive option in this regard. However, there is a major drawback to annuity products. Many employees feel that while annuities can provide a steady income, it is prone to inflation. For employees working on the mainland, their pensions would be adjusted based on inflation, but there is no such mechanism in annuity products. The payment must be sufficient today, but not anymore in 10 or 20 years. By then, the annuities might not be enough to support the lives of the people. So does the government have any plans to plug this loophole so that annuity products can become a reliable means for retirees? Undersecretary for Financial Services and the Treasury, thank you very much. Since the public annuity program was introduced, we have constantly been refining the system. In the year 2020, the eligible age has been lowered from 65 to 60, and in July, premium discounts for MPF scheme members was offered. We want to better educate the public on annuity products, and later we would explore further ways to refine our annuity program. Mr. Wong Kwok-kin, which part of your question wasn't answered? My question was very clear. I asked about how the annuities can stand up to inflation. Secretary, This is one of the options we once discussed in the context of annuities, but since inflation is unpredictable, economies with a similar system would offer a fixed increment every year, for instance, 2%. But if that is the case, the initial level of annuity would be lower. So this would be one of the factors we consider in reviewing annuities in the future. Mr. Hun Xiuping. Madam Deputy, I was recently asked by retirees whether now is the right time to purchase annuity products. Should they wait till the review on the conversion of MPF benefits into annuities be first completed before considering a purchase? Hong Kong's retirement protection system is inadequate and it's often criticized. The government refused to accept the proposal of universal retirement protection from the labor sector. This is disappointing. You said that according to the policy address, there are four main areas of focus in poverty alleviation, including the abolition of the offsetting arrangement to lower the management costs of MPF schemes and to pay MPF contributions for low-income employees. And specifically for the mechanism to make contributions for low-income families, I'd like to hear more details. Are you going to pay the MPF contributions for housewives who are working? In terms of paying MPF contributions for employees whose income is below the MPF minimum relevant income level, this would be implemented by the time the MPF platform is implemented fully in 2025. As for at the moment, we have no plans to study the making of MPF contributions for those who are unemployed. This is the final oral question of the current term of LegCo, and I think this question has come at a timely opportunity. In terms of conversion of MPF benefits into annuities, this has been much discussed recently, and I was asked by many people who were employees whether the government had discussed these options with us. They suggested the government to issue high-yield bonds, and this would be a better alternative to annuities. Since this proposal was announced, certain people with ulterior motives have been trying to scaremonger. So my question for the Secretary is whether you can clearly elaborate on the plan and how it would be implemented. Now, with the enactment of the National Security Law and improved electoral systems, we are very much looking forward to peace in Hong Kong, Secretary. The policy address mentioned how we can encourage retirees to convert their MPF benefits into annuity products which can provide steady income. Some people ask whether the government is making the conversion mandatory. I have said that this would never happen. Whether it is the chief executive or the Secretary for Financial Services and the Treasury and myself, we have said that we would not be mandating such move. Mr. Wilson Orr. Madam Deputy, the Secretary said MPF is an important retirement pillar. and abolition of offsetting arrangements has been discussed for years, and annuities can indeed provide a steady and consistent income. So with the proposed enhancements, and these have been discussed in abundance by the sector, some people are concerned whether the abolition of the offsetting arrangement would lead to layoffs. Secretary, are there any ways to allay these concerns? What is your view on such concerns? Secretary, thank you for allowing us to reiterate our stance again. In terms of the offsetting arrangement, the arrangement is not retroactive. That is the accrued benefits for LP or LSP could, well, the accrued benefits can continue to offset the LP or LSP liabilities before the law is enacted, and there are no benefits for employers in laying off staff. On the other hand, they would accumulate a higher ceiling for LS and LSP payments. So are we concerned that there would be waves of layoffs from employers? The answer is yes, since some employers might not understand the arrangement, or they might misunderstand the arrangement. So our duty is to lay off why employers would lose out if they lay off employees before or after the law is passed. So if they lay off staff, if they do not lay off the staff, their commitments on LSP and SP in the future would be lowered for the employers. Mrs. Regina Yip. Apparently, I heard that from the secretary that Hong Kong people would not accept things that are forced upon them. Before the reunification, the implementation of MPF was controversial. Both employers and employees were reluctant to accept the system. So after reunification, I wonder why the government kept saying that things were not possible, including the green code for resumption of travel across the border. For any policy decisions, we must first examine every available possibility. If employees convert all their MPF benefits into annuities upon retirement, well, if we make this mandatory, we don't see how the public would accept it. Ms. Odin Chow, Madam Deputy, in the main reply, the Secretary said the EMPF platform will be fully implemented in 2025, and the government will pay the 5% MPF contributions for persons who make less than $7,500 per month. And according to reports, the Secretary estimates that there will be 200,000 such people. For anti-epidemic measures, the government said that there are difficulties in identifying certain segments of people. Since you will be paying MPF contributions for low-income persons, in other words, you will have a database. Would the database be used to identify needy people in future initiatives? Secretary, do you have such plans? Since you are, well, Secretary, in terms of the government paying MPF contributions for low-income persons, the employer is obliged to make a 5% contribution, but for employees making less than the minimum revenue income level, that is $7,000, the government will agree to pay the MPF contributions for them. So the government does not own such data or statistics. And in the anti-epidemic fund or employee support scheme, we are making use of the databases of trustees. The databases are not owned by the government. We still need the employers to authorize their trustees before data could be submitted for application of ESS. So this is not about the utilization of databases by the government. This is the final oral question of the current term of LegCo. Mr. Paul Chair. Thank you. Madam Deputy, I agree with what Mrs. Regina Yip said. Things were promised. For instance, the government said there would not be abolition of the offsetting arrangement, but now it's happening. And the MPF system itself, its ministry in nature, according to Chinese wisdom, we have to prepare for the worst, and children should take care of the elderly. The latter might be difficult now, but for the former, we see that the majority of the people would plan for themselves or their own future. Well, assuming the secretary will still be in office, in terms of whether there will be mandatory conversion of MPF benefits into annuities, would the Hong Kong public actually trust the government? How can the government reassure the people that no more mandatory measures would be imposed, secretary? Thank you for allowing me the chance to reiterate our view. In terms of the conversion of accrued benefits of the MPF into annuities, it is not possible to make this mandatory. I was referring to this specific measure. The reason is that public acceptability is very low. We must consider public acceptability in any policy. So if the society changes its view in the future, the government might revisit its stance, but as things stand today, we do not see this happening. This is the end of the questions.
Government bill. This council resumes the